Good evening, Emporia State University. Really nice to see you. Some of y'all must have needed extra credit. Thank you for coming out. You know, I learned a couple of things since I've been here today. One of them is that this is the Twinkie capital of the world. I didn't know you had a competition, but congratulations, you win. I also learned that there are a lot of airlines that are built out here, aircraft. That's really cool to know. And I also realized that when you're leaving Wichita, you should go to the bathroom before you leave, because apparently you don't stop. You just go. I want to thank you for coming out this evening. I'm very, very excited to have this conversation with you, especially at a school where education is so important. Rare is the occasion that I get the opportunity to speak to education schools or students who desire to be educators. And that's a powerful experience for me, because some of you guys may, hopefully, be somebody with whom I work. As an aside, I'm not window shopping. I'm actually here because I want some people to come join us back in Harlem or in Connecticut in what we do. But along the way, what I want to do is I want to have a conversation, and I mean that sincerely. Because it's all too easy to get caught up in what someone who is said to be an expert thinks. I believe that you have opinions that are important, though not always correct, but still important to hear. And one of the things I want to talk about tonight is yes. It's such a small word. Yes, it's such a small word, but it can be so powerful. So much of what we see when we hear people talk about education and is no. I know that in ed schools, what they often teach are things like putting the classroom rules together, right? That's a big thing. And so you and your classroom sit down and you write all the rules of the classroom, because God knows, because it's on the wall, it's a law now. This is exactly why this child is going to behave, because it says on the wall, no chewing gum, that's why I'm not going to chew gum. It says, no being disrespectful, and therefore I am going to always be respectful. I believe that once you get to the contract, if you have to refer to the contract, chances are the relationship has already fallen apart, and that's in trouble. But we don't often hear is yes. And the reason I say we don't often hear the word yes as it relates to education is because we're constantly telling children to say no to something, say no to their friends, say no to drugs, say no to so much, as opposed to saying yes to who they are. The challenge that I find most often in education is that the system is not designed to produce educated people. It's designed to maintain employment. It does that really well. In most traditional school systems, anywhere from 95 to 100% of the faculty will be invited back. But in those same school systems, you'll find in some urban school systems less than 10% of the children reading, writing, and doing math on grade level. But it's easy to look at it from an urban, suburban or rural context and lose ourselves in the facts. The facts are that the ACT reported, starting almost 5 years ago, that 75% of all the people who took the ACT in the United States of America, the majority of whom are white, who went through good high schools, took AP courses, took college preparatory courses, 25%, only 25% were college ready. The school system that we currently call the public school system was not designed to prepare young people to participate in a college experience. It wasn't designed for that. In 1635, when it was designed, it was designed to make sure that young people had something to do in between their agrarian responsibilities. It was designed to ensure that we found some people in some communities and provided them with some access to what was believed to be education at that time. In fact, if you look at many schools today, if you get past the smart board and some of the other technology, it's set up and run virtually the same way it was at the time when what we refer to as public education was established. It's literally the same way. In some cases, if you go to New England, you will see schools that were designed and, in fact, are still in operation from round about that time. Some of them have buildings that were built in the 1700s. And very little has changed in the way in which we administer an education. Because the expectation is that the students should just sit there while the teacher just tells them what they should know. We don't push the paradigm. We don't encourage the growth. We've created this system that has replicated itself over and over again, and we call that the public education system. Yet the only thing that makes it public is that the public finances it, because it's not the public education system until the public is educated. And by educated, it means that we're able to participate on the level that's expected for the next level of life, which in 2017 should be college. You've heard the term college and career readiness. If that's to be the case, then why is it that not only are our pre-collegiate examinations, both the ACT and the SAT, saying that we, those people in public education, are not educating the public, and you, many of you who are professors, are saying, yeah, that is true. When they come here, they're pretty far behind. And then many of you as students, even you as students, remember the first time you wrote a paper and thought, oh my God, we didn't have this when I was in high school. They didn't ask me to do this, and I was one of the good students. I did well at whatever school I came from. The reason is because we're not saying yes to the right people. We've designed at this point in the American conversation around education a fantastic employment opportunity, but not a very good educational model. It does not do a great job of educating American children to participate in a global economy. How do you know? Because all of the data keeps telling us the same thing. How many more times does somebody have to show you the NAEP exam, the NAEP exams results? See, we're saying yes to something, but not the thing that matters, which is the education of young people. In order to do that, we'd have to shift the paradigm. We'd have to make some fundamental changes in the way in which education occurs. For instance, we'd have to have an honest conversation about race and class in a real way. Not in a smoothing over it, we just finished Black History Month so we can go back to the other stuff kind of way, but a real way. A real honest conversation about why is it that children have to go to the school closest to their house? Who does that benefit? We wouldn't send somebody to the hospital that's closest to their house. We send them to the best hospital. We don't just send you to the college that's closest to your house. We send you to the best college you can get in and afford. The fact is that the system that we have needs to be shaken, stirred, and in many cases undone. Because the only way that we're going to get to the point where yes can be said to the right people is if we look at education for the way in which it should operate in today's modern economy. Which means that it must educate children to participate in an economy that in many cases doesn't even exist. For jobs that are yet to be discovered. For circumstances that are still to be developed. The understanding that we are educating young people to do things that we don't even know how to do yet. Long gone are the conversations around being able to leave high school or leave before you graduate and get a good job and take care of your family. You hear our president talking about bringing manufacturing jobs back. Really? Have you seen a factory lately? There are not a lot of people in them. They're machines, computers. We have to design an educational system that supports the development of the people in it for the economy into which they will be spilling. Which means we have to challenge some of the status quo organizations like teachers' unions, politicians, and the like. We have to push back on these organizations and ask them, why is it so hard to fire a teacher who isn't doing her job? What is the reason why we need a certification? Why is it that you go to school closest to your house? Why is it that you can't go to a school in a different part of the state? What is the reason why that some people in teachers' unions are against charter schools? Why is it that they say that everything's about privatization? What is the real issue here? The real issue is forever now, we've been fighting to maintain a system that has ensured that certain people got to go to good schools and certain people did not. Poor people of all colors have never been included in this educational conversation. Because if that were the case, we would have figured this out. If we were saying yes to poor people, poor white people, poor black people, poor Latinos and Latinas, poor Native Americans, if we were saying yes to poor people, then we would design schools or design an educational process that provided them with access to a quality education and didn't require that they move. Dr. King, in his final book, Where Do We Go From Here? Community Chaos, in his final chapter, said American schools do not know what to teach or how to teach. That's Dr. King. You'll often hear people say, well, the problem with education today is that we're teaching to the test. See, what happened is we lost the lust for learning because we're teaching to the test. And tests don't tell you everything. And so if we keep teaching to the test, we're really stripping down the curriculum. And as a result of that, children are not really learning. That's what's happening. That's not true. Because if we were teaching to the test, then more children should be performing better on the test. But in fact, what we're seeing is that in some states, the test scores are slipping. So if we're teaching to the test, if that's what we were doing, if that's what we were saying yes to, then we should see some results. See, what starts to happen is we start to say yes to things, and then we start to see that that which we say yes to is what we work towards. If we say that we want everyone to have access to a quality education, then we begin to design systems that ensure that that occurs. We don't limit them to the school at the end of your block or the school in your community. We say the best school for you or your family, period, bar none. See, we need to rewrite the term public education. We really need to fundamentally change what we think public education is. You'll often hear people say, I don't support charter schools, I support public schools. But charter schools are public schools. Yeah, but they're corporate-run schools. Everything that's not an individual is a corporation if it's an organization. It's just a tax status. It's just the way that you refer to something that's other than an individual. You're either an individual or you're a corporation. You incorporate, like a city is incorporated. So then we have to ask, so why do we keep having these, what's the riff? Why the issue? If some schools are performing better, then why not open more of them? Whatever type they are, charter, Catholic, magnet, vocational, technical, traditional, home, online, why would we do that? Why would we stop that? Especially considering we have a teacher shortage. Let's be real. When you graduate from Emporia State with a teaching certification, and if you can't find a job, there is something wrong with you. If you can't find a job in these here United States with a teaching certification, well, maybe if you're physical ed, maybe you might have a little trouble. But other than that, just keep it real. You may want to continue to put some science in your life. Take a couple more science classes, please. The reason why we consistently have these conversations where we riff over which type of school is better than the other is because typically, the type of school that is most likely to have people who participate in teachers' associations or teachers' unions are traditional schools. And any threat on that is a threat to having access to the power that they've been able to maintain for many generations. You see, I didn't vote for Donald Trump. Shocker. And I can understand why people watched Betsy DeVos's confirmation hearing and struggled to like her, and have watched some of her gaffes as of late and struggle as well. But that's not why she's the biggest threat to the traditional system, and why Donald Trump is the biggest threat. It's because what Donald Trump is doing now is he is saying what many parents have been saying for many years. He's saying, I want the parents to decide where to send their child to school, and I'm going to make that easier. In 1635, 382 years ago, when Boston Latin was started, a school that still operates, by the way, when it was started, it was started with the expectation that this community would raise money and they would educate their own. And that method of operating public schools has remained to this day. If you live in a certain area, you're supposed to go to that school. And though some of you may go to different schools because your family can afford to, or because you play basketball really well and you somehow end up at this school in which you don't live in that neighborhood, or if your family's brave enough to lie about your address, or you test into a testing school, or you somehow, but for the most part, the majority of people will send their children to the school closest to their home. What Trump and DeVos right now are doing is threatening the status quo. They're saying, again, stay with me here, they're saying that they agree with the 82% of African American parents who said that they support school choice and charter schools in particular. They're saying that they agree with the overwhelming majority of the very conservative, largely white, Midwestern and Southern populations, and saying that they also want school choice. So what's happening now is that there is this confluence of issues where you have two groups that seemingly had nothing in common except for the fact that they are parents and they want the right to choose the school to which their child attends. That's all they're asking. This most revolutionary of concepts. Think of this. This is the greatest threat to what's referred to as public education of our lifetime. If you see the maintenance of the status quo as something that is to be defended and upheld, then this is the greatest threat. If you see the status quo as something that has stood in the way of gaining access for all people, if you see it as something that has limited the growth of communities, not just geographic communities, but cultural communities, if you see it as something that has somehow limited the growth of our nation with less than 25% of all children who took those examinations, who are entering into college, many of whom, 1 in 4 in some schools, and many as 3 in 4 in other schools, will take remedial classes for no credit but will pay for them. If you think that maintaining that system is in fact something that is worth doing, then this is the biggest threat. And the biggest threat is this: allow the parents to decide. Don't allow the zip code to determine where a person has to go to school. See, it's difficult for many of you because I would presume there are very few of you who are parents. But those of us who are parents see this as our obligation to choose the best school for our children, whether it means moving into a community and hoping that that school system works out really well, and then over time realizing that that one may not be best for you, and if you have means, you can choose other options. Or trying to create your own schools, which is where I come in. what I said yes to was this idea that I didn't want to accept that black children in particular, minority and poor children in general, were just less intelligent. Stay with me. One of the biggest hustles in American history is racism. It allows some people, many of whom are white, to believe that somehow, through some accident of birth, that they are somehow better and hold a higher social status than another group. And why that's a hustle is because what it does is it allows one group to think that they're better than the other, thereby creating this chasm where neither of them communicate with one another, not looking at the fact that they have more in common than they have that separates them. And so they're allowed to linger in their own what are essentially intellectual ghettos, thinking that if I live in a trailer park but I'm white, I'm better off than the black people who live in what we refer to as a hood or a housing project, not understanding that both of you ended up where you are because of things like urban renewal, where they put poor people in places that no one else wanted to live. You ever notice how wealthy people rarely have their homes flooded by major water bodies of water? Do you ever notice how in wealthy communities, they rarely have bad schools? That hustle that's racism allows us to stay at odds with one another and not have honest conversations and say, wait a minute. When I hear people talk about their experiences of poverty, I didn't live like that, but I lived in a rural community. And we had those same struggles. So maybe we didn't live in Wichita. Maybe we didn't live in Kansas City. But it's the same as me. What I said yes to was this notion that if we created a school model, a method of delivering an education that was exactly the same as those in the wealthier communities, or even better, the ones that people paid for. If we created a school that was literally designed exactly the same way, with exactly the same expectations as the wealthiest, in many cases, whitest private schools, then we could perform what I believe to be one of the most revolutionary acts ever. We could provide access to education and liberate the minds and hearts of young people who had never known themselves to be smart. We could teach them that there's something beautiful and fantastic inside of them, encourage them to push themselves beyond anything they could have ever imagined, create this notion that there's something powerful pounding inside their chest, regardless of their zip code, regardless of their parents' education, but in fact, given to them by a higher power, if all we could do was create a similar system, one with the same expectations, then we could get them to say yes to education. If all we did was replicate. What you'll find in many low-performing school systems are the following elements. Low expectations, which manifest themselves in the types of courses that are offered in their high schools, and the types of rigor that occurs in the elementary schools, and the expectations occurring in that elementary school at the earliest of grades. So you'll hear people saying things in poor schools that kids who are 3 and 4 shouldn't focus so much on learning to read, they should learn to play more. And that sounds like it makes sense. You think, yeah, kids need to learn to play. Have you seen children? That's all they do. Try and stop a child from playing. But if you go to one of these wealthier schools, they're reading by 4. Full-on reading. That's expected. That's not negotiated. And how dare you tell them the professor such and such's child isn't going to read until she's 7 or 8 or 9 or 10. Yeah, good luck with that one. See, what happens is, in these other schools where they're successful, the expectations are high upon entering. In the poor performing schools, the expectations are low upon entering. And you'll hear people say, yeah, but the kids coming to the low performing schools only have so many words in their vocabulary, and the other kids have more words. What the hell? That's why they're in school, to learn more words. That's your job, teach them more words. So if they come speaking a different language, so they don't know as many English words, does it mean that linguistic skills are not as good? Well, you understand their parents don't read to them at home. Okay, you knew that before you worked in the school system. What we did, what we said yes to, what we continue to say yes to, is setting the expectations upon entry and saying things like, every single child will go to college. That's one thing to say that, but it's another thing to believe it. And you know you believe it when you actually do it. When what you do is you create a system, a pipeline of sorts, that sends kids to college. More specifically, at these successful schools, at these high-performing schools, at these wealthy schools, they don't have remedial classes. They just don't. And it's not because they don't have students who need remediation, but they find remediation through some form of integration in the classroom. They provide additional reps and additional staffing to provide them with the support that's necessary to be successful, so they don't find themselves in classes like extended algebra or consumer math. See, because one of the reasons we started our school is because I had worked with a not-for-profit organization that we started, an Upward Bound program, where we would go and work with low-income, first-generation students who were going to be going on to college, and we would work with them while they were still in their regional high schools, and we would go there, and I saw all my kids from my Upward Bound program who were in this class called Extended Algebra, and I thought, wow, Extended Algebra, algebra sucks already, and you're going to stretch it out? What did this child do? And what Extended Algebra did in this particular school system was it gave children algebra in the first semester of their freshman year, second semester of their freshman year, and first semester of their sophomore year. They then didn't take math again until their junior year, in which they began geometry. Now, for both ACT and SAT, you need algebra 2. So this school had created a pipeline in which the children could not be successful. When I went to visit these schools over here, there's no such thing as extended algebra. It was either algebra or AP algebra. That's it. You continue on. In the poor performing schools, what you see is that the homework doesn't really exist. Children may have some busy work that they do at night, but it's not homework. These schools over here, 2, 3, 4 hours of homework a night. In addition to having a 2-sport requirement, 2-varsity sport requirement every year for 4 years. Here, you don't have to stay after school or do anything. But here's where the fundamental shift is. At many of the traditional schools, what we found was that the way that the organization was designed was to not be too taxing on the staff. So when I ran a school in Hartford, Connecticut, in Hartford Public Schools, teachers only needed to be to school 10 minutes before school and 10 minutes after school, and one day a week stay for 45 minutes total. They had a 6.5-hour workday with a duty-free lunch for a half hour and a 45-minute prep, thereby cutting their workday down to just about 4 hours, 4.5 hours. When I went to visit these prep schools, they had to teach a full load, advise, meaning they had 15 or so students who they met with on a daily basis and provided them with academic support, and coach at least one sport a year. If it was a boarding school, they had evening responsibilities and weekend responsibilities. They even had to eat with the children. Whereby in the traditional schools, because the objective was to make sure that the staff was comfortable, during their duty-free lunch, no principal could assign them any responsibilities at all. And in fact, in one situation I'm aware of, a young lady who was a math teacher working in an urban school with which I worked had instituted something that she called a brown bag lunch. And so during her lunch, she would invite students to come down to her room. And this was a middle school. And you see all these kids walking down the hall with their trays. They made their way into her room, packing her room, to do math during lunch. Her union grieved her and said, "You cannot work during your duty-free lunch period. And as such, if you continue, there will be sanctions against the school." Her principal had to make her stop. These schools over here, they have breakfast with the students, they have lunch with the students, they have dinner with the students, and in some cases live in the same dorms as the students. These organizations over here are student-centered. They're saying yes. They're doing all they can to build the students up so they can be successful. Over here, the goal is to make sure that the faculty is comfortable. So what we did was our best impression of what we saw over there. So at our school, every student has to do two sports, but every faculty member has to coach. Every faculty member has to teach a full load, and every faculty member must advise, meet with at least 15 students every single day, and help them go forward. Well, the results of when we said yes were, since 2006, the first year of the first school that we opened, we've sent 100% of our graduates on to four-year colleges. As of last night, the school that we just opened in Bridgeport, Connecticut, the one in which we accepted children from grades 6 to 12 all at once, in a city where 100% of our sixth graders were doing math below grade level, 100%, every single one of our graduating seniors at our school in Bridgeport has been accepted to a four-year school because we said yes to children. What my challenge now is to get you as educators in training to say yes to children, to not get caught up in this notion that somehow you are the victim in this situation, that you are the one who's being maligned, that because your job is hard, that you're the one who's struggling the most. Families depend on you in ways in which you could only imagine. Children will wake up just to see you. Parents will call you when they want their child to do something. You'll be the one at the Sweet 15. You'll be the one that they look up in the stands to see if they're playing football. You'll be the cheer coach. You'll be the track coach. You'll be the advisor. You'll be the person who puts together the multicultural organization on campus. When you say yes to children. When you say yes to children, when you make this about kids as opposed to yourself, what you will have created is an environment within which children love themselves and, quite frankly, fall madly in love with you. You will be the source of their inspiration well into adulthood. Many of you can today think of a third grade teacher, a kindergarten teacher, a middle school teacher who so inspired you that even today, as you prepare to be an educator, you think about her or him. You think about the way in which they engaged you. You think about how they inspired you. You recognize that if you could just be a fraction of what she was to you, to your students, what a successful person you would be. That's a person who says yes to kids, who doesn't get caught up in the system. See, the system was not designed to educate children for this current economy. It just wasn't. And as a result, it is not. It has been designed to make sure that the individuals who work in it keep their jobs. And as a result, it does. It's impossible to say that this system that has been replicated all over the country that consistently produces the same results is doing it by mistake. It is not. It's doing it because that's the way it was designed. And it was designed really well. My challenge to you, as colleagues on some level, even if we don't work together individually, but because you work in the field within which I feel like I live for, it's imperative that I make it clear that you must always put the children first. Always put the children first. There's nothing that grates me more. Well, there is, but this one thing that really is when I hear people say, I spent $200 on my kids last year. Like, I give a damn. Of course you did. So what? If that's too much for you, don't do the job, man. $200? A pair of sneakers would cost you that much. This is the deal. If this is hard for you, then don't do it. I was asked earlier, what would you say if you could talk to some of the people who are working in education or who are in the ed schools? Be more selective. Sounds counterintuitive, right? Because we have this shortage. But I actually think that the more selective you are, the more people want it. Push students into the field sooner and keep them there longer so they learn more about what it is to teach. Because teaching is not just talking. Because I've seen a lot of people talk. There was this gentleman who was a Spanish teacher in our school, and well, he was a Spanish teacher. I know that because I filled it out to say he's hired as a Spanish teacher. And I know he spoke Spanish because I recognized the language. But he really performed Spanish. Because he was the only person in the room who could speak Spanish. And he was a really nice guy. But he did not have the ability to take an idea from his head and put it into the heads and hearts of other people. And as a result, he would stand there and the kids would look at him and he'd look at them and they just sort of looked at each other until the kids realized, I'm not learning anything. And then they did what kids do when they realize they're not learning anything. What I would want from you, Emporia, is for you to challenge your students in such a way that you challenge them to think, is this what I really want to do because I want to teach? Is it what I want to do because I like the schedule? Why do you want to do this? Because it is hard. It absolutely is. It absolutely is. And when you're child-centered, when your focus is on children, when you understand that you have a moral and ethical obligation to ensure that every single child, not just the kid who seems to get it and you just go back and forth and the two of you during class and you're talking and he's talking and it's like you two are just having a conversation, the rest of the kids like, I don't know what, they ain't talking to me, so I'll just sit here and act a fool because these two got a nice little thing going on. But if you are about making sure every single child in your class understands and can read, write, and compute on grade level, if that's what you're about, at least on grade level, then this job will at times feel impossible. You will cry a lot. Tears will become something that just happens to you. You think, wow, am I pregnant? Because I just cry a lot. It is imperative that during this time, when you're still in school, that you ask yourself this question. Is this what I love? Would I pay to do this? Not would I get paid, but would I pay to do it? Because that's how you know if you love something, because you're going to pay for it. You're going to pay in ways in which you have no idea. Especially those of you who are going to really get into it. Your partner's going to say, well, you really have to go back to school tonight? Yeah, the kids are having a dance. Do you need to go in on Saturday? Yeah, I'm going to go. I'm going to go check on my room, get it ready for Monday. Another professional development? Mm-hmm. Yes. When this is what you live for, it is hard. It is hard. I promise you it's hard. But if it's what you love, if it's what you say yes to, then what feels hard will change the lives of children every day. You have access to what I think is the coolest profession out. It's like Groundhog Day. Every day you get to do it over. if your prom sucked, you get to go to prom every year. And you know what's going to happen at the end, and that might be good for you. You don't have to worry if he's going to come pick you up or she's going to come. You don't have to worry. You know how the prom is going to go because you're in charge of it. You get to experience the best parts of elementary school and middle school and high school every single day until you deal with adults, and adults suck. Like, they're just a lot. I don't care which ones they are. They're just a lot to deal with. You just think, wow, how old are you again? But when you love it, when you truly love it, it's heaven. When you truly love it, Sunday is a day of excitement. All of your friends, they all know every kid in your class. They know every story about every kid. They know your favorites. They know the ones you struggle with. When you love it. When you love it, when your kids fail an assessment, you feel like hell. You don't blame the test. You don't blame test taking. You don't blame the kids. You look at yourself. You get online. You find out who did it well. You go observe your colleagues in another class. You go and find your administrator or department chair and you say, hey, I didn't do that well. I'm going over my data and I'm struggling. I'm not seeing things go well. Do you have any ideas for me? When you love it, that's how you treat it, because you want to be amazing at it, because you understand you are saying yes to children. And when you say yes to children, children say yes to themselves. When you say yes to children, they find something inside themselves that didn't exist. Children do not need you to tell them where they are. They know where they live. They know what their life looks like. They need you to tell them where they can go. They need you to help them to dream. They need you to speak in terms like magic and wonder and joy and bliss. They need you to help them to see that, yeah, I understand that you live here now, Chief, but you don't have to stay here. Listen to me. Jump on my back. We're going to do amazing things together. You and I, we're going to inspire one another. I love the way you draw. You can be an artist. You're a fantastic singer. You should be a teacher. Oh, my God, you'll be a fantastic dentist. You will be able to inspire them beyond anything that people even in their lives who love them can do. You'll be able to say to them things that their parents can't say. When you love it, when you truly love it, the children will see in you something that they've always wanted to see. They just need a yes. They need to hear yes every day. They need to know that you can do it because there's something inside you, and I believe in you. And because I believe in you, we're going to figure this thing out. I'm not going to let you take a remedial class because there's no reason for that. The research is clear. If I put you in a slower class, it doesn't speed you up. That's crazy. And I'm going to get into my school and I'm going to fight with administrators or anybody else who creates this environment where we have low expectations of children. I'm going to hold my colleagues accountable, because when you love children, you will fight anybody who stands in the way. You identify with the children more than you do the adults. You will have conversations not about what type of school, if it's a charter, if it's a traditional school, if it's a public school, if it's... You don't care, man. You just want it to be a good school where people are saying yes to kids every single day. If it's a homeschool, welcome home. Whatever it is, you will find a way to inspire those young people to be better than they could have ever imagined, because you're saying yes to them. Because you know that the system has said no. The system has said, stay in your community. Go to school not far from your trailer park. Go to school not far from your housing project. Separate them and keep them separated forever. Sprinkle racism all over the top of them and make them think that they'll never, ever have anything in common. Let them think because they live in a certain neighborhood they're bad at math. Let them think that they can't learn to read. Let reading on grade level seem like it's something that's so amazing and impossible. That's when you say no. When you say no to the kids, you identify with the adults more. You walk by one of your colleagues' classrooms and you see, you know she's not teaching. And those of you who've done student teaching, you know what I'm talking about. You walk by and think, wow, Yeah, they're not. Those kids are not learning anything. You've walked by. You've seen it. You've heard people talk about children. You think, my God, that's a kid. He's like eight. Did he really hurt your feelings like that? He's eight. He said you had a big belly. You do. Get over it. My challenge is to get you to say yes, to always remember that this is about children. The most amazingly designed schools are designed for kids. They feel like Disney World. There's just a wonder. When you walk in, it just feels like, wow, what an awesome place to be. In science, we're going to blow things up today. In math, we're going to discover these fantastic theories. We're going to read about history. That's what school should feel like. School should feel like love. At the end of the day, when you say yes to children, you're really saying yes to love. You're saying, yes, I love you. And because I love you, I want the best for you. And I don't care where you come from. I don't care who your parents are. I don't care how much money they make or don't make. I don't care what addictions they deal with or don't. Because the truth is, all children are at risk. All children. Doesn't matter how much money the parents make or how educated they are, or even if they are educated themselves, it doesn't matter. They're kids. And they, like water, will make their way through any crack. And so we have to do all we can to shore it up. And we shore it up with love. We build that love, that wall of love, so strong and so high. And we support systems and individuals who support children. And we stand in the way of anyone who will do anything different. So I'll finish here. Say yes to kids. Say yes to kids because they deserve it. Say yes to kids because you may be the only person in their life who says yes to them. You may be the only one to tell that little girl, you are so pretty. That little boy, you are so handsome. You are so smart. That little girl, you look like a scientist. When I look at you, I see a scientist. You remind me of the scientist that I saw one time. Oh, you want me to show you her? And watch as her face lights up. Oh, you want to be a chef? You remind, oh, there's a chef that I've seen. That, oh, man. Say yes to kids. Because at the end of the day, when you say yes to kids, you're saying yes to yourself. Here's the trick in this education thing, when we do it right. Each one of us has a kid inside of us who still wants people to say yes to him or her. And the more of that that you share, the more that child comes out of you. And the better you exist as a person, the happier you become in your space. See, that yes doesn't just come out of your mouth, it comes back in. Because what you are saying yes to is you are special and I can see it. And they will in turn say to you, well, you are special too. And don't think that you're ever going to be too old to appreciate someone telling you that you're special. So in the time that you have in this school, and as you prepare to educate others, say yes. Say yes as often as you can. Thank you so much for your time and attention.
We have microphones up here and some time for some questions.
Hello, my name name's Murad Jalilov. I'm a political science and English language major. I was just wondering, I do agree with the perspective of charter schools and voucher schools, and I agree that that teachers need to like work hard to educate their kids, but with the recent budget cuts that's been going on, my concern is that what if the teachers are underpaid and if the vouchers are like not enough to pay for schooling, so for schools to function, what if they close down?
So
like, what would happen?
So thank you for your question. Let me see if I can answer it a couple ways. First of all, one of the big problems that we have when we have a conversation about education and funding and being underpaid is we don't know what being overpaid is. We've yet to establish what the rate is. We don't know. So people use the term teachers are underpaid without necessarily knowing what teachers should be paid. And if so, by what metrics will we measure? So we have to, that's one thing to keep in mind. The second, I think the bigger part of your question has to do with what happens if you give a kid a voucher and they leave a school and that school closes? Well, the truth is that the school was supposed to be open for the kid, not for the people who work there. So if the kid is somewhere else, then the money should be where the kid is. For instance, some of you receive financial aid, right? Anybody here receive financial aid? All right, good. So that financial aid goes with you wherever you are. Were you from Connecticut, your financial aid wouldn't be at UConn right now. It would be at Emporia State. It makes no sense to leave the money behind because you're not there. Second, what we don't realize when we have this conversation around the money, because when we have that conversation around the schools closing, what we're doing is we're saying we want to make sure those people don't lose their jobs is what we're really saying. Because we're not saying that we don't want the kid to get an education. We're saying we don't want the people to lose their jobs, which is not really my concern. If these people don't want to lose their jobs, they should run a better school. But the bigger challenge is that we don't have an honest conversation about what actually is happening. There are many traditional schools. Let's say a child has special needs. If that child has special needs that extend beyond that school's ability to address them, they send them in many cases to a third party. That money goes with that child. And that child could still graduate from the traditional school, though the services are provided by an outside provider. That happens all the time. I mean, all the time. We don't fret that because that doesn't threaten the traditional school's current operation. It's only when that money leaves and that kid's not coming back that we start having the conversations and concerns. You hear people say, well, it destroys the community if you close down these schools. Well, A, in many cases, they're not schools because the kids are not learning in them. Just because it's a building that says school on the outside doesn't mean that they're learning in it. And just like here, if Emporia didn't do a fantastic job of inspiring you to learn and you all left, no one would be compelled to keep this school open. It would, like many other universities, close. So they are compelled to produce a product that's going to be consistent with or exceed nearby competition. And as a result, you have people like you who come from all over the world to participate in this academic experience. So if it works at the post-secondary level, then why can't it work at the primary level? It actually does. We've been doing it for years. The concern that you see now, and this is largely driven by the teachers' union in particular, is that they're going to lose the union jobs. That's really what this is. They're going to lose the union jobs. Charter schools make up 6% of the teaching of the student population in America. 6%. Some estimates are as high as 7. So it means 93% of the children are doing something other than going to a charter school. Not a real threat. And that took 25 years. So if you double that, right, another 25 years, it'd be 12%. Not a real threat. The real threat is in places like Detroit, where in 2000, there were 186,000 students in the school system. And then in 2015, there were only 40,000 in the school system. Those families had had enough. Now there are 55,000 in the charter school system in Detroit and 40,000 in the traditional school system in Detroit. It's a democracy, and things change. Systems of education change as they should. And parents are making decisions, especially poor minority parents, are making decisions to not send their child to the closest school to their house. So I am not the least bit concerned about a school that can't keep its numbers up. That's not my problem. And that's not our problem. That's their problem. They should produce a better school. There's nothing that stops them.
Thank you, Dr. Perry, for sharing with us tonight. But my question was lightly touched by your response. There's this idea that kids with developmental disabilities are not unteachable, but they will never reach the potential that neurotypical children will achieve. And I think this is a serious issue. Do you have any suggestions for addressing that in a school setting?
Yeah, so there, I have thoughts. It's a broader answer, because I would have to first know what the specific challenges of the child are, or the population that you're talking about. Autism is one thing, developmental delays are another thing. There's still other issues within there. There are cognitive, social-emotional issues that exist. There's some compounded issues around trauma that children are dealing with that's now becoming an issue that we're talking more and more about, which is trauma, which can be external or internal. There are other forms of that. So there are a lot of issues there. So I don't know that there's one answer. But what happens in American society is that the pendulum swings from one extreme to the other. So initially, what we did was we took all the children who had special needs, or so we believed them, and we warehoused them. That didn't work. So then we took all of them, and then we put them all mainstream. That doesn't work. In some states now, there are laws that say that a child who has special needs needs to spend at least 85% of their school time in a traditional school, what they refer to as regular ed peers. But what if they don't need 85% of their time with the regular ed peers? What if they would be provided with access to something else? And then there's other parts of this conversation that are not often discussed. There's sexism as it relates to boys. I'll explain that in a moment. There's racism as it relates to minority boys, and the over-identification of both of them in special needs populations by typically an all-female teaching population. So there are gender issues even that we don't often have a conversation about when even identifying a student with having issues. Because sometimes the children are identified because their behaviors are what we refer to in some cases as just, as you used to hear, boy being a boy. Sometimes boys play differently than girls, and so sometimes the boys may play more rough. Sometimes they may play more rough. Sometimes they may. And are too rough for a particular teacher who feels like that is somehow the beginning of a conversation that she needs to have with the child's parents, which can become something far greater. The point is, no matter what we do, we have to be mindful of all of the other environmental factors that get us to a place where we're even talking about this particular child. We have to look at data in a real way. And then as we look at data, we have to create the least restrictive environment. There are students who have attended our schools. It's just the wrong school for them. I mean, it just is. It's not safe. I remember one child we had, he was a runner. He would just take off. Excuse me. And he had a para, but the para would sometimes have to take a break. And he would just dart out. And in that school, we were in Hartford, and there were 6 lanes in front of the school. We found him out. I mean, he was 6 years old. I mean, he made it out. So, I mean, he didn't make it out, but he made it out one time, and it's all you need to do is make it out one time. So my more global answer to your question is we do have to take into consideration, first, how the child is identified, meaning what strategies we use to identify him. And then look at what is truly the least restrictive environment. Keeping in mind the pendulum swings, right? The new now, wow. So I don't know that I can think of an autistic child who I know of who was put in a regular life setting and with additional supports, and he's fine. He as fine as can be. Went off, graduated from high school. He didn't make it to college, but he went off to high school and graduated from high school. And he's a fully functioning member of the society. Then there are other children who are nonverbal. For a small school like mine, I can't really service that kid. We just don't have the staff. He needs a 1-to-1, if not 2-to-1, in some cases, depending upon some of the maybe OT, PT, whatever else he may need. So we don't have that. And though we get some of the Title I money, some of the special ed money that comes with them, it's not enough to hire somebody full time to take care of that. So it's a ongoing conversation because we've yet to because of the isms that are so caught up in it. I'm thinking of the institutions that we used to put kids in, and even when I was in high school, there was always a room in the school that those kids went to. We called it Room 6, and that was where the kids went, and they would come in on the short bus, right? Ha ha, funny. They'd come on the short bus, and they would go. But the truth is, at some point, they leave high school, and they have to have some skills, and we didn't have it was vocational skills always, but that's not always the issue. I met a man in Baton Rouge last week, who said that he was identified as learning disabled. And his mother refused. She says, my son's not learning disabled. And she fought like hell. So when I met him, he was a sophomore in college last week. There's no single way. But what has to happen is that we have to engage the parents and the school. And here's where it gets really screwy. When the school is right and the parent's fighting. We have a student in our Harlem school. The parent is just fighting like I don't want y'all to label my son. Okay, fine, ma'am, but he won't sit in the classroom at all. Y'all just want to run tests on him. And in her mind, she's thinking of tests in some draconian zombie apocalyptic thing she's thinking tests are something that's going to hurt him. And she's thinking the label is going to limit him. She's not seeing it as something that we want to do so we can say to the state, now you have to send us some more resources so we can support. And first 6 or 7 times she didn't return our phone call. We had to call the state on her to get a return. So it's just a more complicated mixed bag than what do I think. And I feel like I needed to say that in that way to this group so that you understand that you're the first line of defense. Many of you who are elementary ed teachers in training, you'll be the first one to see some of these behaviors that'll make you wonder, why is he laying under the desk? Why does he have to touch everything? I mean everything. What does that mean? Why is he so clingy? Why is he putting his hands on his ears? What does that mean? It was not even loud in here. What's he doing? Why does he sleep so much? And you have to do a biopsychosocial analysis to get a better sense of what's going on with this child. And then after that, put in place a strategy that you constantly update. What happens is people put together an IEP and they just keep it for the year. Not realizing that if it's done well, child could essentially earn their way out of being identified as special needs. And in fact, we could find other things and put them in regular ed. So is that helpful? Okay. Hope it didn't sound like I was double talking. I just wanted to give you a more robust answer. I felt like you deserved it. Howdy. There's one there, unless you really like that one.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Kate. My name's Katie.
Hi, Katie.
So my question is, you talked about having the same rules and regulations between the public schools and private schools and the charter schools. I went to private school all my life, so like from the time I was in 6th grade, if we left a notebook or anything at home or in our locker, we would get a pink slip and that would eventually lead to detention. So are you saying that you think everything should be the same with academic rigor or discipline, or if the kids don't have the resources to even bring those notebooks to get that discipline? Would you provide the resources or?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. So I think thank you, Katie. I think that the expectations must be the same. I think schools should be different, but I think the expectations should be the same. I'll give you, for instance, there's a charter school system in Texas called the IDEA Public Schools. Amazing. You should look it up. IDEA. And at IDEA, they have the overwhelming majority of their students are going to be first-generation collegiates. And many of them are poor and Latino and Latina. Some schools, you can actually see Mexico from the school. They require every child to take 8 AP classes while still in high school. Require. So it's no surprise that I met a young man who had come to the U.S. as a freshman in high school from Mexico, not speaking English, who was going to Brown University. The expectations are the same. When we opened our school in Hartford, people told us that the kids wouldn't be able to afford the uniforms because we had them in blazers, and the blazers were $100. They told us that they wouldn't be able to afford the ties and the crested shirt and the khaki pants and the shoes, the dress shoes. They did. Occasionally, there's someone who can't. Occasionally. But generally speaking, people tend to find a way to make that happen. And so if it's a notebook, we're talking about a dollar or two. And if that were the case, then someone, if it was an honest challenge, would find a way to support them in that. But the expectation should be the same. Because at the end of the day, whether you went to a private school or she went to a neighborhood school or she went to a charter school or she went to a magnet school, you guys are all here at Emporia. And the professors don't really care what school you came from. They're expecting you to perform on the same level. And that's what ultimately we have to keep in mind. The expectations have to be the same because we can't think of them as elementary school students, middle school students, or high school students. We need to think of them as sophomores at Emporia or Wichita State or University of Texas or whatever the school may be. We need to think of them as that because that's what they will be. And then we need to think of them as neighbors and colleagues and police officers and firefighters and all these other things that are important to us that we want people to be good at. So we have to hold the expectations to the same level because just in the same way it made it possible for you to be successful, it makes other people. All we did in our school is run it exactly the same way. Exactly the same way. When I say exactly, I mean exactly. We talk about our school in the same ways as the elite private schools. We treat our children the same way. And as a result, we get the same or better results. 100% since 2006 have all been accepted to four-year college. You can't beat 100%. It's because we've designed it exactly like the other schools, which can be a shock to the system for many people because grown people don't like rules. They think they're adults and they're a parent, so they don't have to listen to our stinking rules. And so when we say you have to have a black belt and they send a child to school in a blue belt, they say, what's the big deal? It's a blue belt. I say, if it's not a big deal, then put them in a black belt. Well, why is it that you can't, because our children wear sweaters. In the lower school, they wear sweaters, and in the upper school, they wear blazers. So they have to wear a white crested shirt, even under the sweater or blazer. Well, what difference does it make? If it doesn't make a difference, wear the crest. Because what happens is, what you may not have realized, what you may not have realized is that all those rules built a culture, and that culture produces a result. And if you take any parts of that culture out, you taint the result. Well, what happens with a lot of traditional schools is they take some parts of ideas that they hear of or some programs that they saw at a conference, and they try to bring parts in. So when we started our school in 2005, and we were in a school system that only graduated 29% of its students, And then here I come, a social worker, saying I'm going to start a public school, and we're going to send our kids to four-year colleges, and they're going to wear ties and blazers. The backlash from the school system. How dare you do that to those kids, make them wear those blazers? They're never going to want to do that. Why would you do that to them? It's elitist. That's racist. I'm racist? You just want them to look like white people. Not really. They're still black. It's just the blazer. It comes off. You're good. And so when we did that, as part of an overall experience that we called a prep school, children saw themselves in that space as they're going to college, and this is a prep school environment, and this is what it was, and that you do things a certain way, and it changes the way we communicate one to the other if that's how we think of it. So when we started sending 100% of our kids on to four-year colleges, I get a call from one of the other principals in Hartford, in the public school system within which I'm working. She says, hey, where did you get those blazers? I said, I can tell you where we got the blazers, but that's not really the deal. You should come over and see the rules, like the rest of it, like why the blazers work. There's a reason why the blazers work. Yeah, I know. But I'm not trying to hit all that, she said. Where did you buy the blazers? I'm just trying to get the blazers. I said, Superman's power is not in his cape. You can dress like us, but that won't make you like us. You do what we do. So here's the back part of that story. So one day, I get a call. This is a true story. I get a call from the Hartford police saying, because everyone knows our blazers, right? At this point, we're 8 years into this experience. At that point, we were. And everyone knows our blazers. Our teams had become very successful. We had won state championship in football, though we were the smallest high school in the state. Won in basketball 5 times for the girls, ranked 15 in the nation. Even won a cross-country state championship, right? It was funny in the beginning, seeing little black kids running around the block in basketball sneakers and getting lost in the woods. It was real funny until nobody got lost anymore and we started busting people's behinds. Then we won a state championship. Then it stopped being funny. It wasn't funny. So we were well known. So I get a call from the police. I get a call from central office, not the police. I get a call from central office, Hartford Public Schools central office. And they say, Dr. Perry, your kids are down in Center City fighting. That can't be happening. I will be right there. So before I leave my office, a police officer calls my cell phone, who had known. He says, Dr. Perry, you know it's not your kids down there. We know your kids wouldn't be down there fighting. It's the other school that bought the Blazers. The rules that created the ethos of your school created the experience that is your school. And it brought the best, I bet, out of a lot of people. And it created something that made this all possible. So if I were to say I wanted the same results that you had at your school, but I don't want to do it like you do it, I want to do it light. I don't want to have every single kid. I bet you didn't have remedial classes that you remember in there, right? Remedial classes. I bet you had college prep classes, yeah. Right? You just know, right? You had college prep classes in AP, right? Because nobody would pay to send their child to a school with remedial classes, because that's just silly. Except, of course, those kids who don't have options, they send them into remedial classes. If we want to truly replicate the results of schools like yours that have been results for hundreds of years, then we have to simply do what you guys did, which is to keep the expectations high on every single child. Otherwise, we can't expect a different result. And that's been part of the problem in public education. Generally speaking, no one's holding our neighborhood schools accountable, especially when they're educating poor children. And so if no one's holding them accountable, one parent comes in and says, because the traditional schools try to do this in many urban centers. They'll say, you have to wear a school uniform, and then the Board of Education will fight and fight and fight, and they'll make the kids all wear a uniform, right? And then you go to the school. I went to the school in the Bronx. with a parent. And I saw one kid, and that's not a lie, I saw one kid in a uniform. I said, that's a really interesting little guy. Why is he wearing a school uniform? She said, that's the school uniform. The entire school's uniform. Yeah. Oh, wow. He's the only one wearing it, huh? She said, yes, my son. Where a lot of the traditional schools fall down is they try to gimmick their way or back their way into real reform or real fundamental change. As parents who they send their kids to schools like yours, but as practitioners, they don't run schools like yours, because one parent will call in and she'll be fighting mad. She'll say, I can't afford this uniform. And then some will say, well, you don't have to wear a uniform. We understand the low, you know, you heard the George Bush once said, what was it, the low expectations of racism or soft or something like that. When we keep dropping that bar because some parent calls up on fire, then what you get is what you see, which are these lawless experiences for a lot of kids, and where kids honestly are afraid to be in school, and honestly afraid. I know schools, I mean, too many schools to name, where kids are patted down every single day before they enter the school. Every single day, a full pat down. Bags open, patted down every single day. In the city that I run a school, in Bridgeport, Connecticut, it takes 25 minutes to get into the building every single day. And yes, it's cold outside. 25 minutes to walk into the building through an archway metal detector in which they go through your bag every single day. Because God knows if you were going to bring a weapon into the school, you would bring it in through the front door where the metal detector and security guards are. We operate in the same exact city. We run a school in the same exact city. We had one fight this year. Same kids. No metal detectors. None. All we did was change the expectations. It's not that we put the kids in clothes. We taught the kids what the clothes represent. So when I'm disciplining a young man, I say to him, do you honestly think that you're going to walk around the city representing us in our crested blazer and you're going to act like that? You think that that's going to be okay here? You're in the wrong school, son. Go somewhere else. You don't want to be here? You don't want to wear that crest with pride? Take it off and never come back. There has to be, it has to mean something. It can't just be clothes. And so I would imagine that you remember fondly your experience, especially as you reflect on it and you hear about other people's experience, you think, wow, I was really blessed. That was a pretty good thing. And to the best of your ability, you'll try in a classroom, presuming you work in it, to replicate that. But it's really hard to replicate that in an organization that isn't that. And it's the reason why many people go right back to those schools and work. There was this young man who I met who had gone to Duke University. I met him. He was working at a boarding school, African-American. And I just knew I was going to get him to come work with us in Harlem. And he said, and he was working at this boarding school that he had gone to. He said, nah, man, I'm not leaving here. This makes sense to me. And he had worked at other places. The point is, in order to do what you guys did, you had to do it the same exact way. And there are things I could tell you about the school and that without even knowing it, just because you said it was a private school and it was a college preparatory school, I could tell you that your highest math class was at least calculus, probably calculus one. Right? So, these are things you just know. This is universal all over the country. The same model. It's the same exact model. So you ask yourself, well, why wouldn't they do it in the other schools? Because the other schools were never designed to prepare all the children in there for college. They just weren't. And they still are not. And they're not going to be. They're never going to be. They're never going to be. Never. Never, never, never. They will never. And people say, how? It's the truth, man. Not in your lifetime. It's not going to happen. You can hope. Good luck. It's not going to happen. The truth is that those schools are designed to do exactly what they've been doing, in some cases, for 200 years. And they will continue to do it.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Hi, Dr. Perry.
Hi.
My name is Alexa. I have a question for you today in regards to something you had answered on a question earlier. You said that you don't have the resources to help kids with disabilities and or special learning needs. I grew up with an older brother who had Asperger's syndrome, and we attended a public school. Up until his junior year, he had paraprofessionals practically doing his homework for him. He was left behind in the school system, and it made him unable to socially interact with people because of being stuck in one room. So I beg to ask you, what would you do, per se, if you had a student attending your school that did have a learning disability, such as my brother's, and did require a lot of attention? Because, I mean, whether you have the resources or not, if there was something a parent wanted their child to attend your school, and they have the financial means, I mean, obviously you would have to make it happen. You can't just not tell them they can't attend, period.
So let me just clarify. I'm not saying that we don't have resources to deal with all special needs. I was saying there are some special needs that extend beyond our capacity. That's not just us, that's any school of any type, traditional, public, or charter, or private. That's why they have some of these outside providers, because that's what they do. So that I was making that reference. And it isn't so much the parents' means when you're working with a public school, it's what we have. So we have children who have autism, we've had children who have Asperger's. It depends on the level, depends on the function.
Out of curiosity, have you ever had anyone with special needs and or Asperger's syndrome go through your school and attend college?
Yes, we had a student who, well, special needs, yes, quite a few. Again, I work in urban education. 26% of the children in our Harlem school, almost 27, are special needs. And 40 students in particular have what they call 12-to-1-to-1, which is a 1-to-1 setting. So yes, and we've had a student who was LD, who did go on to a four-year college. He didn't finish, but that was his decision, he and his family. So yes, we have.
I was just wondering, because I mean, if the public school system, obviously there's a lot of cases in which students don't graduate with a knowledge level of the grade that they're graduating at. I think it's a very not talked about issue, not talked about enough. I mean, it's talked about, but it's not talked about enough of students that are 18, 19 years old graduating as a 12th grader, but really only had the education of a 7th grader or below.
Well, I'll tell you that I agree, but I'll tell you it's even more. That's why when I started to answer the young lady's question earlier, I said that it's a much broader question, because it isn't just what do we do for special needs kids. There's so many special needs that there are, first of all. Second part is that I have students in our school in Bridgeport, Connecticut, who are not special needs, who are reading 6th grade levels below, at least. So it's a much more global issue, and one of the challenges is, because it's both so emotionally and politically charged, we rarely get to a point where we're having an honest, thoughtful dialogue about what works, because the people who care really care, and the people who are politically connected to it are really politically connected. And so, unfortunately, what too often happens, per my experience, is we don't always get down to the issue, right? So as you heard me say earlier, whatever the IEP says, or I don't know what you call them here, is it IEPs?
It's an IEP.
Okay. So the IEPs, while they're written, they're just guidelines. They're at leasts. They're not only. And when they're monitored effectively by the whole school or the student's whole team, however she, he is situated in whatever grade configuration you have, what you find yourself in is in a position where you can constantly work towards and monitor that. And I know many people are against standardized tests, and I am not, because they do tell us things that we need to know. But I want to make sure, and I want to make sure that I definitely don't leave here giving anyone the impression that I am pro any particular type of school. I'm pro school choice. And I believe that there are great charter schools and great traditional schools and great home schools and great alternative schools, because there are some alternative schools that are really good for children with Asperger's, their children with autism, and parents choose them. I can think of a school that I'm aware of in Connecticut that is designed specifically for children with autism. And is designed on so many levels, just everything from the light, the way the light is in the classrooms, to what noises are in the classroom or not, the way the doors lock, the furniture that's there, keeping in mind that some children are still not, don't have the motor skills that they should have. So if you think of that as the institutionalization of the 60s backwards, then that's frightening to some families. I know of cases of parents who didn't have their children who were autistic. I don't have as many kids with Asperger's. It's not something that I've spent a lot of time with. But we have one student in our schools who does have it. But this family didn't want their child labeled, and so they didn't get him the birth to five services that he needed, and now he's still nonverbal, and he's 8. So there is no easy answer. There is no one that I've known has been such an expert that I would push them out in front to say, now you ask that person. The best answer in the world is that the parents and the school work tirelessly to monitor back and forth on a weekly basis. How'd he do this week? What'd he do? What's the homework like? Did he try? Did you give him homework? Because what happens with students who we see to have disabilities, we often don't even try. We don't even let them try. Excuse me, and intentions in some cases are really solid. Well, we don't want to do that because we don't want to hurt his feelings. Okay, well, nobody's ever died from hurt feelings. It'll be all right. So it's again, as I said to the young lady who asked the question earlier, it's just not that simple. In practice, it would be so easy for me to get up here and just dog out traditional schools and say, no, they do bad. No, they don't. There are a lot of them that do a really good job. In fact, some of them do a far better job than any private school or small charter school will ever do. They have an entire group, like a little army of people who this is just what they do. And I put my money on them any day against someone who it's just not what they do. And if you don't have kids who are constantly in the system who are like that, you don't build up the organizational memory and skill set that's necessary to support the children who are in that space. It's just one of those things. So I don't know if that was helpful.
I mean,
not for your brother. I recognize I can't do that, but I'm just saying, generally speaking.
I was just curious, is your opinion on it?
Okay. Thank you.
We probably have time for one more question. Go ahead.
Yes, hey.
Hi, I'm Calliope, and this question kind of bounces off the one before hers. You were talking about the expectations being high regardless of what kind of school it is, but we're in Kansas, and it took you from what you taught here to go pee, right? So there's not a lot of choice.
She's not lying. It really did. I was thinking, well, are we there yet? You can't just step out of the car because everybody can see you, because apparently y'all don't have bushes by the side of the road either. You may want to invest in that.
Well, all our trees are imported too, so that's okay.
Wow. Wow.
My question is, since there isn't a lot of choice and a lot of times you have to go 50 miles before you can get to the next option, how do we raise the standard and the expectations within the limitations that we have here?
So, thank you. Kentucky is really, when we can figure out how to do it in Kentucky, we will be able to figure out how to do it in the entire country. And I really mean that because Kentucky has big cities, I mean legitimate big cities, legit big cities, and then you have legit rural. I mean, I just saw it. And so there are a lot of answers that I have to that. Because actually, one of the areas that I think we don't talk about are rural schools. Or in some states, they have what they call regional schools. So it's a school for a couple towns, right? Probably have.
That's where I went. I graduated from four towns and one school.
Right, so the same thing. So here's, and I'm going to add a little piece to it. One of the hardest parts is getting people to work there. Because you got who you got. If it takes that long to get there, you don't typically have a large population from which to draw to even hire people. So not only is this the only school you have, these are the only people you get to work with. So there are a lot of solutions, believe it or not. The internet is our friend. And so what has to happen in those schools is students have to have access to courses, not just a traditional online, like you sit there and type something in, but an actual interactive course that has to happen. Because you can't offer, let's say, Calculus 2, like let's say the young lady, Katie, asked earlier, Calculus 1. You can't offer that if you only have two kids in calculus. You can't hire a full-time person to teach two kids. And rare is the occasion you're going to find somebody who teaches calculus well and those other courses well. Typically, it's just not the case. So you have to be able to buy into courses or be able to have courses that are available to the students that wouldn't otherwise be available. In addition to that, you might be surprised. I think, how many of you have actually been to New York? Okay, cool. So you might be surprised to find out that at least 50% of the students who come to our Harlem school are commuting at least 80 minutes. And I say that because for you, you think we're driving 60 and 70 and 80 minutes, but you're not alone. School choice has with it a challenge. You have to go to it. There are a number of ways that could occur. Transportation is let's say transportation is the issue. So the first part I gave you was to create some courses that can come into the school where it is. Another one is to create essentially, I'm calling it a bus line, where a grouping of communities agree to pay for a bus that goes and drops kids off at separate schools. This happens all the time. All over the country, they establish bus routes where students will get picked up in this town, and then this town, and then this town, and they drop them off at different schools. Same bus. It's not a city bus. It's a school bus. So that's another way. And then the other is to, I spoke with one of your local media folks today, and I said to her, or open your own school. There are people whose children they feel are not getting the education that they feel like they deserve. Start your own school. Fight for charters, fight for vouchers, or something like that. That provides you with the opportunity to send your child. So there's three separate options. And then the fourth, of course, is just hope like hell that the one that you have gets it right, which is probably not the best option, but likely one of the first options that you end up having to deal with. Because there is no easy answer. But some of those answers are well within reason, and they're not much more costly. The bus costs the same amount of money, whether you stop once or you stop five times. You pay for the bus for the day. So when you pay for the bus for the day, it is what it is. So we actually underutilize many of our buses by not truly utilizing them. So you pay somebody to be a full-time bus driver, but from 8 to 1, they ain't doing nothing. as you know, you could stagger start times. There are a lot of things that you could do to make that possible. Is that helpful?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Folks, I thank you so much for your time and attention. Really do. I know that this is a long day for you, being in school and all. But thank you for having me.